This is Damon. Damon, it's like hundreds of British journalists who come to Cannes every year. They arrive here full of hope, full of dreams, and full of money. But all too soon, reality hits home, and they run out of booze.
Year after year, at the midway point of the Cannes Film Festival, scores of critics and reporters wind up broke, dead, or even sober.
So is this a problem that strikes every year?
Well, yeah, you know, it starts quite early on in the festival, and suddenly, you know, everybody's, you know, we're all desperate. I mean, it's just...
As you can see, this is a problem that's reaching epidemic proportions. Something must be done, and quickly, and it can be with your help. Just £5 will get Damo a bottle of rosé. £10 will get two bottles of rosé. £25 with a 25% off discount to the local offie will get us a case of rosé. Only with your help. Please call a number at the bottom of the screen and help us replenish our rosé reserves and get our film journalists pissed. Bonjour the web, day 8 of the Cannes Film Festival Videblogisode finds us going distinctly British. I'm outside the UK Pavilion at the moment, and inside, my esteemed colleague, Mr. Damon Wise, is hosting a Q&A with some of Britain's finest filmmaking talent. And in just a few seconds, I'll be talking to some of them on Her Majesty's Secret Sand. Just over there. Okay, what brings you to Cannes? What were you actually here to do?
We're just wrapping up we've just sold the last territory on The King's Speech, my new film starring Colin Firth, Geoffrey Rush, Helena Bonham Carter. So I was here making sure that all went well.
What about Cannes in general? Is it a place you come to often? What do you think of it?
Last night was surreal, because I ended up at a party on Paul Allen's yacht.
Oh,
and, you know, do you remember the Bond film where the ship swallows other ships? So you walk onto Paul's boat and it has a, the back comes down, and inside this huge chamber is a 12-person submarine and a 60-foot tender. I mean, it's like an aircraft hangar, and that's the inside. And I honestly felt like I was 8 years old and appearing in my own Bond movie. I mean, it was quite surreal. And what's also odd is, you know, the reality of being a filmmaker is you don't have enough money constantly, and it's always a fight with not enough funds. And you come to Cannes, and there is just wealth beyond imagining all around you, and you kind of wish that a little bit more would actually filter down to where the ground troops are working, actually shooting the bloody things.
Has it generated a lot of interest in the States? Have people been giving you offers to direct?
You get everything come through, right through from sort of like super low budget huckster shyster producers Facebooking you and saying I've got this thing, right through to some pretty serious guys calling you up and saying, do you want to do a $20 million thriller? So
right.
You just kind of sit back and see what happens, and definitely the BAFTA nomination has created a lot more interest. But what I really want to know is, why are you interviewing me when at a 180 degree angle you've got a perfect can thing?
Yep.
Sam, you've got to turn around and catch this, because it's just perfect can. You are, of course, focusing on the party going on and the majestic barrier.
Yeah, obviously. Ooh, 7 floors up, that's a whole lot of high. Now I know how Jimmy Stewart felt. Anyway, BBC Films has established itself a reputation as one of the finest film companies in the world. I'm here for the launch of their new slate, including a sneak peek at some of their new projects, and I'm going to talk to their creative director, Christine Langan. You talk about the three projects that were announced today. I don't know how much you can actually say about them. For example, the Armando Iannucci project.
The script's nearly ready. I think we'll probably have to get a serious American partner, and the budget will be quite big.
Can anything be inferred from the title, Out the Window?
Yeah, I think there's a little bit of voyeurism. There's a little bit of, we're a very observed society. There's lots of CCTV and cameras. It's about something that somebody sees and they get the wrong end of the stick.
Yeah. There had been a school of thought, or maybe a school of hope, I don't know, that Armando's next movie might be an Alan Partridge movie, but...
I'll keep you posted. That's not entirely... there are things happening.
Okay.
There. And we're in negotiation on that at the moment, so that's... extremely exciting for everyone.
God, I hate sequels. But in this case, I'll make an exception.
Woolley on the web, Woolley on the web. He had a movie with Simon Pegg. Now he has a movie with Sally Hawkins.
But the name has changed.
Woolley on the web. Woolley on the web.
Yes, it's Woolley on the web 4.0, or if you're watching this in the States, live free or die Woolley. Just wouldn't be Cannes if I didn't talk to producer Stephen Woolley about his upcoming projects. And last time I checked, yep, definitely, that's Cannes, all right.
Thank you very much for making me into an institution. I'm really excited about being Woolley on the web again.
Are you happy with the theme tune, though?
You're kidding. I don't know who invented that, but, you know, move over David Arnold. When I first came here, I was buying films, so I was basically going to everything. Because by my old company, Palace, we bought, you know, Evil Dead and Diva and Nightmare on Elm Street and Mike Lee films. So we cover the waterfront, literally cover the waterfront. And I was just running from cinema to cinema. I never saw the sunshine. It was like a vampiric existence. But now, as Cannes goes on, you do more meetings. And
well, of course, you were here last year launching Made in Dagenham. Yeah. Back then, it was called We Want Sex.
Yeah.
Why the name change?
The London Underground kind of hinted that they wouldn't put posters up that said We Want Sex, yeah, as blatantly as that.
Yeah.
Whereas in France, it's still called We Want Sex. Mm-hmm. In Germany, it's still called We Want Sex.
Okay.
But in the US and the UK, it's Made in Dagenham.
Well, what's next for you? Have anything lined up at all?
Yeah, we have lots of great projects. We have a big budget version of Great Expectations that we're putting together. We're just about to announce a director for that. And we have a novel called Strangers by Toichi Yamada, which is a lovely ghost story, which James Marsh, who did Man on Wire, is directing.
Oh,
and we're just finishing the script with Conor McPherson on that one. That one we'll hope to shoot early next year. Do you think the 3D bubble will burst or not?
I think it will burst if people exploit it. You don't want to go in the 3D realm yourself?
I do, actually, yeah. I mean, that's why I'm asking. I'm just wondering if I should be developing some 3D movies.
I think
if you think about it, if we had done the reveal in The Crying Game in 3D, just as he pulls the thing open, everybody would go, whoa! The entire audience would have been rocking backwards.
Yeah. Well, that's it for day 8 of the Cannes Film Festival. Join us tomorrow for more film-related fun. In the meantime, I really fancy catching a screening of Robin Hood, but as fate would have it, a screening of Abbas Kiarostami's Palme d'Or contender certified copy is on at exactly the same time. What to do?
Chris, while I admire and respect the work of Abbas Kiarostami, you know what I'm going to say, don't you?
Robin Hood?
No, the Abbas Kiarostami. Of course, Robin Hood, you muppet, I'm in it. Incidentally, it's in cinemas now.
Yeah, I know that. It's behind me. Thanks, Mark. 2 tickets for Robin Dubois it is, and I guess. See you tomorrow. Yeah. I am so out of a job.